This lecture has been made available to you courtesy of the American Numismatic Society.
It is my great pleasure to introduce and welcome a dear colleague and friend of all of ours here at the American Numismatic Society. This is Professor Seleni Tsoma. She is a full professor of ancient history at the National and Kapodistrian University of Athens. She studied history and archaeology at the University of Athens, and then ancient Greek history, numismatics, and epigraphy at the École Pratique des Hautes Études in Paris, and at the Sorbonne in Paris, which is where she got her PhD and also where she did her habilitation. At the same university in 2006. Seleni has published a lot. She has several books to her name, including most recently a wonderful study on ancient Corcyra in a couple of volumes. She has published well over 90, if not already over 100 articles. And her topic today is one that I'm most fascinated by and very interested to hear, and this is Nomos and nomisma. This is the relationship between law and coinage in the ancient Greek city. So, Seleni, I will turn it over to you after making the note that everybody can find her handout in the chat. So she will be referring to this handout. Please do look in the chat for it and download it so you can follow along. So, Seleni, all yours.
So thank you very much, dear Peter, for the invitation. What can we say? It's 1 o'clock in the States. So good afternoon to everybody. In the Greek world, coins were issued by political authority, a city-state, an ethnos, or a federal state, or a monarch. The connection between a city's coinage, nomisma, and its law, nomos, went beyond sharing a common linguistic root, nem, from nemo. Just as the laws, nomoi, were social conventions enacted and enforced by the state's authority, the coinage of a city was based on an agreement between the state, which is issued the coins, and those who used them in everyday transactions. According to Demosthenes, counterfeiting coins was a crime similar to creating bad laws and was punished with death. In the classical and Hellenistic periods, private banks did not issue paper notes that circulated as money. The state alone controlled the money supply. It was the state that decided about the metal with which coinage should be issued. It was also the state which guaranteed the metallic value of a coin and fixed its nominal value, which was higher than the metallic value. And it was also the state that regulated the use of coins within its boundaries. Different weight standards were adopted, and this was a decision of the state related mainly to trade networks, military needs, as well as changes in the gold-silver ratio. Although ancient Greek coinage was related by all means to its issuing authority, sovereignty and coinage should not be confused. Coinage was a financial instrument par excellence and one of the institutions of the city that decided about its own numismatic policy each time the city either decided or was obliged to have one. No need to change continue with the PowerPoint. A city might proceed to issue a coinage if there was need for it. Exemplis gratio, payment of mercenaries, or daily allowances of a garrison, participation in a trade network, or fulfillment of obligations in the context of an alliance. Let's say at the beginning that coinage was invented either in the kingdom of Lydia or in a Greek city of the western coast of Asia Minor in the mid-7th century BC. This is a topic that Ute Wartenberg and Peter van Alphen know very well because they wrote on that. The stamp of the political authority gave legal tender to the coin struck by the issuing authority within its territories by the Lydian kings. within the territories of their kingdom. The metal used for the earliest coinage was also a decision of the political authority. It was neither gold nor silver, but an artificial alloy of both that Herodotus called white gold and was also known as electrum for its color. The aim of the issuing authority, the Lydian kings, was to make counterfeiting much more difficult and also to prevent their coinage to leave the territories of the kingdom. The next, please. Croesus, the last Lydian king, was the first to mint gold and silver coins with typical Lydian types. Once adopted by the Greek cities of Asia Minor, coinage became a Greek phenomenon, as Chris Hargibor says. 423 cities out of 1,035 minted their own coinage during the archaic and the classical periods. Coiners served various needs of a significant number of cities. One of these were penalties paid to the city. The earliest mentions of coined money in epigraphic documents concern penalties. Coinage was also adopted by the Persian king, his satraps and generals. We can show the next one, please. Several Greek cities, next one. Naxos in Sicily, Syracuse, another one. Next one, Acragas, Catani. And here we are with the Persian king, but also by his satraps. The next one, please. And generals. There are some few known cases of sanctuaries that issued mainly bronze coins with types referring to the venerated god and his name. The next one, please. These were struck with money that belonged to the sanctuary for local use at the sanctuary also during the days of the festival. They began during the 4th century and continued during the Hellenistic period. From the mid-4th century, generals struck bronze coinages with military types and their own names. The next one, please. These bronzes were also intended for local use in the vast military camps of this historical period. Both cases were exceptional and concerned mainly bronze coinages, coinages with a strong fiduciary value, with few exceptions. In both cases, sanctuaries and generals assumed the cost of minting these coins and acted as political authorities without any thought of usurping sovereignty from the state authorities under which they acted. Either these were cities or kings. There were also coinages that circulated outside the frontiers of the issuing authority. Darics, the next one, please. Athenian tetradrachms, next one, and next one. Aeginetan, next one, and Corinthian starters, and also Cyzicene starters, the next one. These were all coinages with high commercial value during the archaic and the classical periods. During the Hellenistic period, the silver coinages of cities like Istiaea, the next one, please, Rhodes, Dyrrhachium, and Apollonia, next one, were added to Alexander's, the next one, and the other coinages on the Attic standard. Royal bronze coinages that are to be found outside the frontiers of their issuing authority tell us very different stories. Let's say now that each coin had three values, the metallic value, you have all in your handout, the nominal value, the commercial value. Let's say also that our knowledge about coinages, coin production, circulation, monetary policy derives mainly from the study of coins, hoards, as well as from various literary sources, epigraphic documents, and papyri from Egypt. From the literary sources, we need to mention the second book of the Economica of a student of Aristotle and the ninth book of Polyx, of the Onomasticon. as far as epigraphic documents are concerned, mentions we have, the evidence we have belongs to five different categories. Laws in the form of decrees that provide regulation for coinages, or laws. Laws and decrees mentioning penalties and the promise to make loans or donate money to the cities and associations. Inventories of sanctuaries that include coins as offerings, and offerings whose weights were calculated with coins. Accounts of various magistrates of cities, sanctuaries, or associations, and private documents or deeds of sale. Now, let's say that what we are going to see are all stated documents, laws, and decrees. And we will see the evidence following the list of decisions that we have. Now, the list of decisions. Just as the political authority in a Greek community monopolized the use of legitimate force in enforcing the laws, it also exercised complete control over the following decisions. First, you have all in your handout, page one, at the very bottom. To introduce a coinage and decide about the metal, the weight standard, the nominal values of the coins. B, to protect its own coinage. C, to determine which coins issued by foreign states would be accepted as legal tender or not. Set exchange plates to appoint citizens responsible for minting coins, to choose coin types and weight standards, to withdraw coinage, to convert local and foreign coins, to protect coinage against counterfeiters. With this in mind, we can now turn to our subject. A very strict number of cities, combined evidence from coins for excavations, patterns of numismatic circulation, and the coins themselves, however, reveal that there were very similar procedures in all Greek cities that minted the coinage. We are going to say more while examining its special case. Introduction of a coinage and decision about weight standard and nominal values. Sometime in the middle of the 3rd century, in the presence of the Council of 300, the city of Gortyna on Crete voted by secret ballot in the assembly to introduce a bronze coinage, to require its use in transactions, and to withdraw the silver obols from circulation. You can also show the following one, please. To indicate the status of the new bronze coins as legal tender, the decree uses the term nomisma. The silver obols to be withdrawn are simply called silver obols. There are also provisions related to those who might in the future eventually break the law, continue to use silver obols, do not allow the use of bronze coinage, and try to make a profit. In these cases, the penalty is 5 starters. With 6 obols in the drachma and 2 drachma in the starter, we are in the Aegean standard, the penalty was 60 times the value of a silver obol, thus a heavy penalty. The procedure is carefully described. Citizens should report any violation of the law to the board of the Neotas that plausibly consisted of neoi, of young people who exercised police duties, especially in the countryside. 7 members of this board appointed by lot as supervisors of the agora should take the judicial oath, judge the case, decide by majority vote, and the person losing the case should pay 0.5 mina to the person who won the case and 0.5 mina to the city. The need for a vote in the assembly and the provisions taken by the city reveal that there might have been various reactions to the introduction of bronze coinage. This had fiduciary value and therefore it was overvalued within the territories of the issuing authority. It was difficult probably for the citizens of Gortyn to accept that these silver obols were about to be replaced with bronze ones. One recalls how long it took the Athenians to introduce a bronze coinage. Dionysius the Halcus gave them very precious advice in the early third quarter of the 5th century, but it was only after the mid 4th century that bronze coinage was adopted by the city of Athens. Although obols and their fractions were very rare in the Kingdom of Macedonia from the late 5th century BC, and were not issued by Philip or Alexander, in the eastern provinces of Alexander's empire, some obols, hemiobols, and even quarter obols, tetartimoria, were struck with his name and types. From the 4th century and the reign of Dionysius of Syracuse dates his initiative to strike tin coins, and we are told that the Syracusans voted to treat these coins as silver ones. We have also other texts about the decision of a city to issue a coinage. We have two epigraphic documents, the treaty between Mytilene and Phocea, we're going to see that at the very end. And we have also the decree of Sistos, the city of Sistos, for Minas. This decree mentions that it was the demos who decided to issue its bronze coinage, and in this case, there was no opposition and need for a vote in the assembly, most probably because the coins were fractions of the obol, and because Sistos had a very long history in issuing bronze coins. Now, we move to the protection of the city coinage. This is the decree of Olympia. The extensive control of the polis over coinage is seen in this decree of Olbia that dates from the second quarter of the 4th century and was found in an Anadoluca duck. That's why I have the map. The Anadoluca duck is a small fisherman village at the northern point of the Asiatic coast of Bosporus at the very bottom of the map, and in the vicinity of the sanctuary of Zeus Urios, Zeus of the good winds, named also sanctuary of the Chalcedonians or Hieron. According to many books of Pergamon, all those who traveled to the Black Sea had to pass by this sanctuary. It was a point of reference in navigation itineraries as the Pseudo-Skylax. It was mentioned in contracts like that of Demosthenes against Lacritus, decrees relating to the privileges received by the Athenians from the dynasts of Bosporus, along with those that the Athenians had accorded them in return, were also displayed there, engraved on stone. And this was the place where Philip II took by surprise a fleet with grain that was being sent to Athens. The decree was therefore strategically placed. Olbia is far away from the place where the decree was found. Now, back to the decree that stipulates that in Olbia and its emporia, all silver and gold coinages could arrive in the city and no taxes should be received for these coins. The dokimasia, testing of the coins, had to take place at the official location on the stone table in front of the ecclesiasterion. This is something that we have also on the new law from the Athenian Agora, the Epicrates law, and is similar to a measure of Byzantium. Everyone in the jurisdiction of Olbia must use the bronze and silver coins issued by the city in all transactions. The city further sets the exchange rate of one citizen electum stater, the next one please, at a certain amount of the city's own silver staters, which means that those that arrived at Olbia with citizen staters would exchange this with the city's own currency on the Aeginetan standard, which was also with a certain exchange rate that was also valid in the Aegean. For all other currencies, the exchange rate should be at the rate previously set, as private agreements were valid. What the ceiling, may I have the next one, please? What the city of Olbia required in this decree from all those who sailed to its harbor to buy large quantities of grain was to use for the transactions the city's coinage in silver and bronze. It was in this way that this very prosperous city protected its own coinage. The mention of Sicilian starters and no other currency of high commercial value, Aeginetan starters, whatever, is due to the fact that this was the currency in which transactions took place in the Black Sea and the Hellespont. We have evidence from this decree of Olbia and also from literary sources, from hoards and isolated finds. What the city of Olbia required was not the use of Sicilian starters, but the exchange with local coins and sets the exchange rate. Olbia was centrally a prosperous city and an international trendsetter for grain. However, it seems plausible that cities less prosperous and important than Olbia could also require the exchange of a so-called international currency with their own coins. The next one, please. Apollodorus, the son of Passion, vividly described his, and the next one, please, adventures while at Trirac. These are Sicilian starters that you all know, and this is the next one, please, the passage of Apollodorus. So he says, in the coinage of one country, the payment was made and what the loss in exchange was. Most probably, Apollodorus had Attic tetradrachms with him and had to exchange them in the cities of Aegean, Thrace, and the Hellespont. The study of hoards and coins found during excavations reveals that what the decree of Olbia required from merchants was almost the norm in cities that had their own coinages. The next one, please. To begin with Olbia, in all hoards buried in the city, the Hora and the island of Berezan, Voristenes, the most numerous currency is that of Olbia, with very few exceptions. From all excavated sites, Athens, Corinth, Olynthus, Abdera, Maronea, and many others, we have information that in all these cases, the vast majority of coins consists of the local currency. So in Attica, 17 of the 25 hoards of silver coins by between the late 6th and the late 4th century contained only Athenian coins, one hoard combined Attic silver and bronze, 12 combined Athenian coins with silver coins of Eretria, the Temenids and their successors, Mithridates the 6th, and the Roman Republic. One hoard had only Darics, another only Sicilian starters, and another only Istrian tetrabulls. From the 33 hoards of bronze coins, 19 contain only Athenian coins, or Athenian coins and coins of Eleusis, all others combined bronze coins of Athens with very few specimens of other minting authorities. The excavations of the most famous agora, the Athenian agora, brought to life 12,676 Greek coins, the majority of which, 10,800, were coins of Athens. The only hoard from Corinth and its hora with non-Corinthian coins comes from the sanctuary of Poseidon at Isthmia, a meeting point of pilgrims for obvious reasons. We can say the same about Olynthus. We can say the same about Acanthus, the same about Abdera and about Maronea. It is a common point between those who study numismatics that a number of sites can be identified by the presence in this of a significant amount of silver, small silver fractions or bronze coins of a certain issuing authority. One recalls that this was the way Louis Robert identified many different sites in Asia Minor. It was this leading French epigraphist who, based on the presence of bronze coins of Zorni, realized that the coastal city excavated opposite Samothrace was not Mesamvria, as the excavators believed, but Zorni. We have some exceptions to this rule, cities that did not have their own currency and used the currency of either neighboring cities or a so-called widely accepted currency, and this to accumulate wealth and proceed to transactions, and also cities that seek to strike their own currency and rely on a currency struck in large quantities. So if we need to make some more comments at A, the cities that did not have their own currency, I remind you that 1/3 of the cities of the Archaic and Classical period had their own coinage. All others relied on coinages of significant neighbors or on international currencies. And this is something that we can also see in hordes. In Thessaly, Elis, and Arcadia, we have Aegean silvers in the 5th century, in most of the 5th century, and we have their own currency from the moment on that they begin to mint their own currency. For as far as cities that cease to have their own currency, Euboea, the cities of Euboea cease to mint their coins around 460, and then they relied on Attic currency. So from all these stories about Olbia, from what we need to retain is that once a city issued its own currency, the city protected it by imposing it for all transactions taking place within its territories. And the city decided about the exchange rate of a foreign coinage within its territory. Now, I move to point three. Acceptance by a city of a coinage issued by others. The cities could specify which coins minted by other cities could circulate, either as legal tender or not, within its borders. The earliest mention of money in an epigraphic document comes from Eretria, Χρήματα, Δόκιμα και Υγεία. The date is the last quarter of the 6th century, and the coins mentioned could hardly be these of Eretria, whose monetary production began circa 500 BC. The coinage the document refers to it to is most probably the Athenian Wappenmünzen that are present in hordes buried in Eretria. Whatever coinage and coins are meant, these were not of Eretria, and it was the city that decided which coinage had legal tender within its territories. We have the very significant decrease of Sinpolitia, this is in page 3 of your handout, between the city of Smyrna and not the city, but the military settlement at Magnesia under the Mount Sipylus. It became later a city. This decrees date from the years of the Laodicean War. There is a special provision that concerns coinage. The city of Smyrna proposed the settlement of Magnesia, the Sinpolitia, that we learned that there was an agreement that the citizenship of Smyrna was offered also to the garrison at Paleomagnesia under the condition that it was surrendered to the city of Smyrna. And apart from some significant details for the registration of the new citizens in the tribes of Smyrna, obligations, rights, and participation in the life of the city, the agreement contained the following provision, and also in Magnesia, the coin of the city of Smyrna should be legal tender. For legal tender, the decree uses the term enomon, a term frequently found in literary tradition to denote legal, but only here in an epigraphic document to denote the legal tender of a coinage. It is worth to mention that the provision about coinage comes third after those about the politeia, the citizenship given by Smyrna to the kātiki of Magnesia, the use of Smyrna's laws. There was need to make clear that the coinage of the city of Smyrna, which in fact incorporated into its citizen body the kataki of these military settlements, was legal tender at Magnesia. Another example, federal states may also have allowed the coinage of member cities to circulate among all members. We have the text, the famous, the next one please, of Polybius. For while many have attempted in the past, etc., they have the same laws, weights, measure, coinage, and standard, as well as the same magistrates, senate, and courts of justice. And the whole Peloponnesus only falls short of being a single city in the fact of its inhabitants not being enclosed by one wall, all other things being, both as regards the whole and as regards its separate town, very nearly identical. The uniformity of laws and legal procedures goes hand in hand with the uniformity of coinage standards. 19 member cities of the Achaean Confederacy minted tribals with federal types from circa 195 BC. This may have happened also with the Chalcedian League because large number of coins, especially bronze from neighboring cities, were found at Olynthus, the league's capital. These cities joined the league during different periods of the league's history. Now, and the very famous text that you have in your page 3 is the Law of Nicophon from the Athenian Agora. This was enacted at Athens in 374 BC and appears to allow good foreign imitations of Athenian silver coinage to circulate in Attica. The relevant clause of this document still divides scholars almost 50 years after its first publication by Ron Stroud. The law begins with an order, Attic silver coinage shall be accepted when it seems to be silver and has the public stamp. These two prerequisites involve an examination. The task of testing and approving coins is assigned to a public slave, who is appointed as dokimastis by the state and is supervised by state by public officials. There are provisions concerning this guy. The days of state payments, he has to be seated in the council. All others, he can do it among the trapezite. In the following lines, we have provisions about two different groups of coins, and here becomes the problem. Athenian imitations of good alloy and second group, forgeries, kivdilon, silver coins of bad alloy with a bronze core, hypohalkon, or elite core, hypomolybdon. We will begin with the second group. This includes forgeries and coins of bad alloy. Does this provision refer to Athenian imitations or to Athenian imitations and Athenian coins? Kivdilon, counterfeit, cannot refer to Athenian imitations, while Attic coins issued by the city's mint could not be of bad alloy, the Ponyra Chalkia of the late 5th century being demonetized after the end of the Peloponnesian War. Athenian imitations could be of bad alloy. Their alloy could contain bronze or plumb, or lead. Thus, it is plausible that this clause refers to both Athenian and Athenian imitations. According to this clause, if the dokimastis tests an Athenian imitation and finds that it has a bronze core or a lead core or an Attic coin and finds that it is a counterfeit, he is to cut it through immediately, confiscate it, and turn it to over to the council. We have many examples of bronze counterfeits from the Mitron in the Agora, and this shows, according to Jack Kroll, that the law was not a dead letter. Thus, the law forbids the circulation of counterfeits of Athenian coins, as well as of Athenian imitations of bad alloy. Now, the first clause that concerns foreign silver coins having the Attic stamp. If anyone brings forward foreign silver having the same stamp as the Attic, it shall be given back to the man who brought it forward. These coins are imitations of Athenian coins that were produced from the late 5th century outside Attica, mainly in Syria and Egypt. It has been assumed that these were issued to fulfill the increased need for Athenian owls, the circulating coinage par excellence in these areas. And this happened when Athenian monetary production was suspended as a result of the Decelean War. However, there were other reasons these coins were minted, as it has been shown by Peter van Alphen. It needs to be emphasized that there is a debate about which coins were Athenian imitations and which were not. As I said, this clause divided scholars. It has been assumed by the first editor, followed by many others, including myself, that Athenian imitations were allowed to circulate at Athens from 375-4. This has been challenged by those who regarded it as impossible that any Greek polis would accept imitations of her own coins. Others assumed that there was an agio, or discount, that had to be paid for these Athenian imitations. But the law does not mention such an agio. Some think that the wording of the law was not decisive on this point, and that the acceptance and monetary values of imitations were matters for negotiation between buyer and seller. But these negotiations are not mentioned in the law, as in the case of the decree of Olbia, and the law is more than clear in what it requires. Now, the idea that the Greek polis did not permit coins of other issuing authorities to circulate without its frontiers is, as we have seen, well documented by the decree of Olbia on evident circulation patterns. However, there were exceptions to that rule, as we have already seen: Smyrna, Olynthus, federal states, etc. Athens seem to have accepted payments with Caesarean starters during the 5th century and used these, as well as starter of Lapsacus, for payments abroad. From the late 4th century, as we all know, and during the Hellenistic period, the gold and silver coinages of Alexander III's successors and other Hellenistic kings on Attic standards, and the coinages of some cities like Istiaea, Dyrrhachion, Thasos, etc., widely circulated and used. Now, according to this clause of the law, if an Athenian imitation was of good silver and had the Athenian types, should be given back to the owner. This is the meaning of the verb apodidomi, apodidoto. According to Battray, this term should not be overemphasized, but as Engelmann very correctly remarked, it reveals an juristischer act. Mit dem das Dokumentum des Prüfers seinen Abschluss fand. This is a legal act, and with this, the Dokumentum of the Dokumentist finds its end. Involved in the discussion is the missing word at the end of the fifth line. The word begins with the epsilon and led to a number of proposed restoration. Based on a second letter, kappa, on the stone that Matthäus says he read, I propose to restore ektypon with five letters, meaning in relief. But Matthäus proposed ekopton with six letters, meaning notching. Both do not create problems for the syntax, and it is not the first time that either an adjective in accusative or a participle, a copton, were proposed for the end of that line. Although the cognate noun ekopi means incision, the verb ekopto is attested only once in relation with coins and means mint, issue, and not a coach, note. This is admitted by Matthäus. A number of parallels for ektypon for other coins or charakter okia. If the letter after epsilon is a ni, two other restorations are plausible. Endipon, with the same meaning as ektypon, or enomon, used for legal tender in a large number, as I said, of literary texts and in the Treaty of Symplegada between Smyrna and Magnesia on the Mount Sipylos that we have seen. In fact, these two different restorations represent two different ways this crucial clause of the law has been interpreted. Can a city allow the circulation and use of foreign coins within its territories or not? The restoration Angelos Matthaeou proposes is in full agreement with the idea that the city did not, should not, and could not allow the circulation of foreign coins within its territories. For him, the first restoration Ectipon does not satisfy the distinction between Attic coins and Athenian imitations. However, this clause concerns only the Athenian imitations and is the following one that concerns both. More than that, he admits that if anyone does not accept the silver which the approver approves, he shall be deprived of what he's selling on that day, with provisions about the punishment of those who do not accept the coins approved by the δοκιμαστής. These do not, in fact, make any distinction about Attic or not Attic coins, it as Athenian imitations. We need to stress once more that this provision about the punishment of those that do not accept the coins that the δοκιμαστής tested reminds us of the decree of Olbia that forces the use of the city's silver and bronze coins in all transactions. At Olbia, those that do not respect this rule were threatened with immediate confiscation of whatever they sell or they buy. One cannot understand the provisions of lines 16-18 if one does not believe that the coins were given back to their owners for use at Athens. How those involved in transactions knew about the decision of the δοκιμαστής? It cannot be excluded that the δοκιμαστής provided the traders that carried with them Athenian imitations of good alloy with the paper, certifying that the coins could be used in transactions at Athens. But it is more than plausible that the δοκιμασία took place in front of the traders. This is what admits Christophe Feyel and others. If we adopt the restoration Ectipon or Entipon, this clause is not extending legal tender to Athenian imitations, but is allowing their use in transactions taking place at Athens and the Piraeus. This is one of the three essential and basic aspects of a law: to impose, to forbid, and to allow. If we adopt, of course, the restoration Ennomon, the law gives legal tender to Athenian imitations of good alloy. There were several now reasons for Athenian imitations of good alloy to be allowed to be used in transactions at Athens. Although Athenian monetary production seems to have continued after the end of the Peloponnesian War, there were financial problems during the 30s. While in the 390s, Athens needed the support of Pharnabazus to finish with the reconstruction of the walls. Xenophon mentioned problems with the mines at Laurion, and later in the 350s, he proposed their reorganization. Attic silver production was not of the level of the 5th century, and this is also revealed by the fact that gold and silver ratio remained 1 to 12 between the late 5th century and the reign of Philip II. Thus, a connection of the admission of these coins at Athens with the limited number of Athenian coins in circulation there is plausible. There might be also needs connected with the creation of the Second Athenian League, the collection of contributions in taxes from allied cities. Partly to these payments point lines 6-8. What seems also very plausible is that we are after the triumph of Athens in the sea battles of both Naxos and Alesia, and the peace, the first Koine Irene with Sparta. This was the time for Athens to reorganize a number of things and turn the market, its market and the Piraeus, attractive to foreign merchants. An agio, a conversion fee, is not mentioned at all in the law. By allowing or giving legal tender to Athenian imitations of good silver without the payment of a conversion fee, Athens' aim was to attract foreign merchants. Whatever the motives of the Athenians were, this was a decision of the Athenian state, and it was by passing a law that Athens introduced this innovation. As we have seen, the acceptance of foreign currency will be generalized during the Hellenistic period. Alexander, other coinages on the Attic standard, and also coinages of cities. Athens' decision to allow the circulation of Athenian imitations by passing the law of Nikephor portended, in fact, the Hellenistic period. This was the case of Athens in many things. And upon adoption of the Deutsche Mark in East Germany on 1st July 1990, the East German mark was converted at par for wages, prices, and basic savings up to a limit of 4,000 mark per person. Contemporary example, except a smaller number for children and a large number of pensioners. Larger amounts of savings, company debts and housing loans were converted at a 2-to-1 rate, while so-called speculative money acquired shortly before unification was converted at a rate of 3-to-1. These inflated exchange rates were intended by the government of the Federal Republic of Germany as a massive sort of subsidy for Eastern Germany. Fixing the exchange rate was a decision of the newly unified German state and was made possible through legislation. This situation, Athenian imitations of good silver to be used in transactions at Athens and the Piraeus without the payment of a conversion fee, came probably to an end at the end of the Social War. Now, we have exchange rate, set exchange rates. Mention of equivalences between coins of different issuing authorities and metals in epigraphic documents gives us the possibility to determine these exchange rates. Inscriptions and literary sources permitted Raymond Bogart to conclude that the price of electrum depended on the price of gold. And hard evidence shows that electrum coins on the same weight standard are grouped together. In some rare cases, the equivalences between different coinages are noted in literary sources. Xenophon above the Persian singlos and 7.5 Attic obols. Apollodorus, the son of Passion, while a triarch, needed to record in the coinage of what country and the payment was made and what the loss in exchange was. Apollodorus had most probably Attic tetraderms, and with this, Xenophon says that he could obtain a good exchange rate. He doesn't say that he doesn't need to change them, but he could obtain a good exchange rate. The decree of Olbia, as we have seen, sets the exchange rate of 1 Sisician stater at 8.5 staters of Olbia. The stater of Olbia was on the Genetan standard, 12.4. 2 drachms per stater, a Sisician stater was the equivalent of 17 Aegineta drachms, or 24 and 1/3 Attic drachms. In this way, the Sisician stater was valued as in the Aegean Sea. For all other currencies, the exchange rate should be at the rate previously set, it as private agreements were valid. Now, there is an anecdote of the 360s. Attributed to the historian Callisthenes, the well-known Callisthenes, involving the poet Persinos and Evulos, the tyrant of the Aeolian Atarnefs. This is a family. Evulos was the uncle of Aristotle and Callisthenes, the philosopher, and Callisthenes was another, was a nephew of Aristotle. So this anecdote reveals that in the territories of Mytilene and Phocaea, one could obtain a good exchange rate for the Phocaides. From the early Hellenistic period date loans from Arkesini Amorgos that note the equivalence between the Attic coinage and the coinages issued with the names and types of Alexander III and Demetrius I. Loans of the second century from the same city mentioned the equivalence of the Attic coinage in general and Alexander. Georges Le Rider advanced the hypothesis that in the frontiers of the Ptolemaic kingdom, an Attic weight tetradrachm of 17.2 grams was exchanged with a Ptolemaic silver starter of 14.4 grams. It est with 2.990 grams of silver as gain for the Ptolemaic state. And he formulated the same hypothesis as far as the Attalid state is concerned after the introduction of the Christophorus. We move now to appointment of citizens to mint a coinage. May I have the next one, please? So this is an Athenian coin of the 4th century, the next one. This is an Athenian imitation. And the next one, this is a pistyle. And then the next one, please. This is a Sistophoric starter. And now, in some coinages, we have from the 6th century on names, first letters of names of citizens written in nominative or in genitive, sometimes with the preposition epi. These refer to citizens that were, in a way we cannot define, responsible for the coinage. Combined evidence from epigraphic documents, coins, and literary sources reveal that in many cases, these citizens were prestigious persons in the life of the community, but cannot be identified with the eponymous magistrate in all cases. Now, the preposition epi is functioning, in fact, as a pseudo-eponymous. There are cases where names were shared by mint officials, eponymous, priests, prytanes, or other magistrates, but this was not the rule. In some cases, these are called archontes, eklogiste, prytanes, exetaste, tamme. The epigraphic evidence we have for the appointment of citizens is rather limited. So we have the final clause of the motivation clauses of the honorary decree for Callinicus of Olbia. We have from the years preceding 169 BC from Delos about the election of more than one person, Ερεθέντες επί την κομπή του νομίσματος, and the coins are the Phoenicophori of Delos, of the Delian inventories, that it est coins with Artemis head on the obverse and a palm tree on the reverse. We have the decree of Dimi that we are going to see. These responsibles for minting the coinage were more than one person, most probably three. Evidence for three people we have also from Kianae in Lycia during the Roman period. And the famous decree of Sistos, which dates in the years following the death of Attalus III, says that after the decision of the Demos to issue its own bronze coinage, to publicize the city's emblems and to make a small profit, Minas, a significant benefactor of the city, was elected ad hoc after having been asked for, together with another benefactor responsible for the minting of coinage. It was because of his epimelia that the city could have her own coinage. And we have at the very end an honorary decree from Magnesia on the Meander for Moschion, son of Moschion. It dates from the early imperial period and it says that this person was appointed catastasis, once more ad hoc to mint bronze coins. We don't know, we can realize that there was a procedure, but the details of this procedure are not reported. In two cases, the officials were elected, Delos and Sistos, and in two others, the officials were appointed, Olbia and Magnesia on the Meander. That means that, as in the case of Thearodoki, there were different ways to appoint the mint officials. There could be one official, two, three, or maybe more. Now, the officials mentioned in the epigraphic documents might be those whose names we have on coins, but also others. On bronze coins of Sistos that you see here, that are contemporary with the decree of Minas, his name and the name of the other benefactor do not appear on coins. This reveals that there were several people involved supervisor and others, and in this case, without holding offices. A number of scholars advanced the hypothesis of a relevant liturgia, it is donation of money to strike a coinage, Bellinger in 1961. But Robert is against, and he says that there is no cash assessment in any document, and that the spirit of the Greek polis was contrary to the appointment of a monetary liturgos. Based on the decree from Sistos, Jones in 1979 tried to refute the arguments of Robert, while Leridaire stressed the demonstration of Sistos' independence through her coins. Now, we need to make some points. First, the decree of Sistos mentions a sort of pride in the city's emblem and in every city's emblems. And these emblems formed part of the city's identity. There is no evidence for payments of money to the city by wealthy individuals to proceed to the minting of coins. The decrees of cities that honor benefactors are very rich in details concerning what these people have done, and there is no mention of money to facilitate the minting of coins. Another significant epigraphic dossier that dates also from the Hellenistic period is that of endowments, donations, never mentions money given to the city to issue coins. Another group of documents mentioning epangelia, it as promises of citizens or others to help cities in need, no mention at all donations of money to mint a coinage. Public subscriptions of the same period never refer to donations of money with the scope to help a city to mint her own coinage. All evidence we have about donations of that type, and they are two or three, date from the early, from the late Republican and the early imperial period. We can thus, I think, follow Louis Robert and affirm that there is no evidence for a so-called liturgia concerning coinage. When a city needed to strike a coinage, the city was able to obtain the metal in several ways. Literary and epigraphic sources say nothing about wealthy citizens or foreigners asked to contribute money for such a purpose, until at least until the first century BC. Now, choice of types. The city's control over its coinage is also evident in the choice of images. The law of Nikophon mentions the types, charakter. The importance of the civic types is revealed by the honorary decree of the city of Sistos for Minas. One of the reasons the coinage, the bronze coinage, was issued was to publicize the city's character. The different types of the same series of coinage, together with weight and diameter, also served to indicate the nominal value of each coin. As Aristotle say, character esti tou posou simion. Coinages depict the most significant deities of the issuing authority, and often refer to heroes, legends, etc. In some cases, we have the most significant products of a city or allusions to them and the deities they are associated with. Demeter, ear of corn on the coinage of Metapontium, Aeneas with his family. The link now between the traditions and the legendary background and of the issuing authority, a coin types are revealed by a restricted number of texts. In the last pages of the handout, I have some of these texts with translation. In all other cases, to explain the types of coinages, we need to collect and take in mind all relevant documentation about the city's legendary and religious background. Now, I will move to withdrawing coinage. The earliest case is reported by Aristotle, and it was done by Hippias of Athens. He rendered invalid the existing currency, promising to pay the holders at a fixed price. But when they came to receive the new coinage, he reintroduce the old coins. We have some other exams, always from the school of Aristotle, Dionysius of Syracuse, Laocoon of Cimmerian Bosporus, although overstriking silver seems to be a marginal phenomenon, can you please, the next one? Next one? Overstriking, these are overstrikes, you see. And the next one, which explains which coin was overstruck on what. And this story stressed the arbitrary way these monarchs ruled. All the accounts illustrate, as Jack Roll admits, how fundamentally Greek coinage was subject to state control and how fully Greek governments were able to manipulate this control for monetary gain. Now, after the end of the Peloponnesian War, Athens withdrew the so-called Ponyra Halkia, issued by the city at the very end of the war due to the lack of silver. We know that from several mentions in Aristophanes, and he mentioned also the decision of the Athenians announced by Kings to go back to the use of silver. These coins were supposed to circulate locally, but we are very happy to have a new law proposed by Epicrates in 354-3, who sheds light in the process of converting foreign coins and minting the silver from this process as Athenian coins for Athenians and foreigners. This text, as well as the ACD, the Athenian Coinage Decree, concern mint activities, contain rules about the conversion of coinage and direct money to the fund of Hephaestus and Athena. It speaks also for money for the general budget, the oikisis, turning bullion into coin, and we have four clauses related to the conversion of foreign coins, and the fifth one concerning most probably the purification of silver or into silver bullion. Of course, as in all laws of the 4th century, all clauses have the form of orders. You have that in the page 4 of your handout. Motivation clause mentions money from the supervisors, epistate, expenses for the Iera of Hephaestus and Athena Hephaestia, and also for the Dikisis. Now we know that this was a significant fund from other decrees. And in the second one, we have mention of the conversion of coinage, money left over, followed by a clause about handing this money over, most probably to these divinities, Ideste fund. The old oligarch speaks about χορηγή for the Hephaestia, and the εκπόματα, the drinking cup of the second clause, might also be connected to the Hephaestia, to this festival. First clause, about a certain place in the Agora to convert silver coinage. Remember Olbia and remember Byzantium. And the second clause starts with mention of money earned by this activity, exchange, conversion of coins in the mint, the use of the verb catalatin to denote this, and the makes clear that what is to be converted are foreign coins. The relative adjective opposon indicates the amount of money deriving from the fees for the conversion of foreign coins and recalls the passage of Apollodorus that you have in your handout and in the PowerPoint about what was the price, etc. What could be exchanged is, as we said, foreign coins, either for coins of the city, a process carried out by private individuals, bakins, or to be melted down into bullion and minted in the local coinage. In the last case, a public official is involved, what seems to be the case here. The practice is known from the very well-known papyrus P. Tenon 59021 mentioned above, while the new law brings additional evidence. We have the third clause with a description of the procedure that seems to be the same with the procedure concerning those that receive their argirion carrying the official stamp επίσημον, and this clause we have the δοκιμαστής, the επιστάτης, and the αιωνημένος, the one who is buying, are mentioned. The clause involved that the επιστάτε and the ιδιώτε receiving the money is the fourth one. We have a command order followed by a purpose clause in the next phrase, which reveals how to carry out the order. There are similar constructions in other documents from Athens. From what remains, we can, from these two clauses, we can assume that private individuals bring coin to an official. The lines 21, the epistati, they give the coins to the public slaves in the meat and compel them to work every day, lines 17 to 19. The public slaves process the foreign coins and stamp the new coins with the Athenian types. The epistate weigh the new coins on the scale with weights. It asks, they check if the weight of the coins corresponds to the Attic standard and are not overweight or underweight. This is the first time that weighing the coins is mentioned. Now, the epistate give the coins back to private people who receive the money after paying the fee for conversion and take this away. The term idiote, private individuals, is used because it refers both to citizens and foreigners, merchants and others, as these are also described in the papyrus from the Zenon archive and in the Athenian law of Nicophon. In the law of Epicrates and in the papyrus, there is mention of the concern of the epistate to accelerate the production of new coins and keep the idiote satisfied. An ancient law, and the law, is mentioned, and the law of line 10 can be identified with the law of Epicrates. Now, about the ancient law, we do not know. From this point of view, the law of Epicrates has common points with Athenian coins. Both concern activities in the meat, contain rules about the conversion of coinage and direct money to the fund of Hephaestus and Athena. However, the Archaeos Nomos cannot be the ACD, the Athenian coinage decree, that concerns payments of the tribute to the, by the allies to Athens and applied also to weights, etc. It seems plausible that there was an ancient law about the conversion of coinage at Athens that was probably older than the Athenian coinage decree. Now, we have the last clause about metal purification. We are not going to speak about this, but this corroborates with what we learned from Suda and the lexicon of Apocrateon. Now, the historical frame of the law is the years following the end of the social war, when the revenues of the state were reduced to 130 talents per year. We know from the Corpus Demosthenicum of a number of measures taken to ameliorate the financial situation of the city of Athens. In the page 5 of your handout, you have also the very significant papyrus from the Zenon archive, which is a letter of the Metrius, the economos of Apollonius. Apollonius was the diketes, let's say, sort of something between minister of finances and prime minister of Ptolemy II. Very significant texts, we have a date for it, 258 BC. Demetrios reports that he faces several problems in implementing the terms of a royal decree, prostagma, concerning the melting down of old gold coins and the minting of new gold coins. And he says a number of details. Can we see the next one, please? The old coins, The old coins are the trichisa of Ptolemy II, that Ptolemy the first, that he began to issue in the early 3rd century BC. They continued until the 260s. Can we have the next one, please? The new coins, these are the Mnea and Pentikondadrachma of Ptolemy II. And some years later, may I have the next one? We have mneia with the name and type of the deceased sister of Ptolemy, sister and wife of Ptolemy II, Arsinoe Philadelphos. The papyrus mentions also the Epichoria numismata, and this must be Alexander's or coins on the Attic standard. May I have the next one, please? This standard was abandoned in Egypt before the end of the 4th century, and a lighter standard was adopted. And I have already mentioned the theory of Leridaire, according to which this gave the possibility to the Ptolemaic state to make a profit from by the exchange of these coins. What is stressed in this letter is the disappointment of foreign merchants who were losing money while waiting for this procedure to continue. It was also the case of the subjects of the king, who had also to change their old three chrysa with the new currency. And most significant of all, the loss of significant revenues of the king himself. Demetrius asks Apollonius what he, who was absent from Alexandria, could not deal with the situation, to whom he should address a petition to accelerate the procedure of reminting. Thus, this private letter addressed by Demetrius to Apollonius, the diocetes of Ptolemy II, informs us indirectly about the way the withdrawal of the coinage and the reminting of the new coinage took place. And we need to mention that this delay, the problems it created to foreign merchants and the locals, and the requirement to receive their money back quickly, strongly recalls the provision that we have already seen of the recently published Athenian law of Epicrates. Let the epistate compel the slaves in the mint every day to work until those who brought in the silver receive it back. Now, the procedures a city might use to control its coin production are revealed by the monetary treaty between Phocia and Mytilene. The treaty concerns the minting, may I have the next one, please, of Nilectum coinage by both cities in alteration. It was decided that Mytilene will be the first to mint these coins, and the coins were starters and the so-called Phocaides, sixth, that we know from literary sources and inscriptions. These were sixth as a state of the starter on the Phocaic standard. It est coins of 2.6 grams. So we have provisions of legal implications for the special functionaries to whom the emissions were assigned. The person responsible for mixing the alloy answered to both cities. An audit of his performance was to be completed within 6 months of the end of his tenure, and the audit board was to be composed by local officials. In case of fraud concerning the alloy of the Electrum coins, there should be a trial with a tribunal consisting for the greater part of magistrates of the city where the offenses occurred. The tribunal should take place within 6 months after the end of the year. If the tribunal finds the responsible guilty, he should be punished with death penalty. If the tribunal finds that he did so not on purpose, the trial should decide about his punishment or the penalty he has to pay. The treaty makes clear that the city of the fraudulent assumes no responsibility. This dates from 360-370-50, but it contains an amendment to an earlier monetary agreement of circa 426 as a result of fraud detected in an electrum starter of Mytilene. This was related to Athenian exemptions after the revolt of the cities of Lesbos. With this monetary pact, the two cities produced the coinage continuously rather than in response to the need to make specific payments. Both cities wanted to create a closed monetary zone where only this currency circulated. This is revealed by hard evidence. Also by the anecdote of the 360s attributed to the 4th century BC historian Callisthenes that I have already mentioned. We know the same, this is also repeated by Thucydides and Demosthenes. So we know that there was a closed monetary zone in this area from the 5th and during the 5th and the 4th, during part of the 5th and also part of the 4th century BC. This monetary unity protected its city and offered mutual guarantees. By creating this zone, monetary zone, these two cities could avoid the bankers' commission. This same treaty and the clause concerning the alloy reveals that the alloy of this electum coinage was an artificial one. Now, death penalty for counterfeiting the coin is also known from literary sources involving Athens and Sinope. We have seen the text of Demosthenes, and Demosthenes says that it goes back to Solon, but nobody believes him. And we have also evidence from Sinope. Diogenes, the famous Cynic philosopher, was a son of a banker, Icesios. You have everything in the page 6 of your handout. And he left his city to avoid death penalty after having counterfeited the coin. The last text that we have is the description of Dyme. Dyme is a small city in Achaia, in the west of Patrae, and the inscription reports death penalties imposed by the city to 6 offenders who were craftsmen and supervisors of the mint and who in their official capacity struck a series of plated silver coins, nomisma ekopton halkion. There were 3 judgments during the same year as they all date from the same Theokolos and Grammatistas, but under 3 distinct voularchoi. From these 6 people, 3 were citizens, as we have their names and patronymics, and all the others were non-citizens. One of these was a Chrysochoros, a smith. The other carried double names. They might have been slaves or apelephthei. It says that his name is Thrason or Thrax or whatever. These 3 were craftsmen, while the others were their supervisors, most probably prominent citizens of Dyme, who betrayed the pistis, etc., the fides of their city. Now, Dyme was a member of the Achaean League and had a silver coinage with issued with names and types of the Achaean League between 190 and 146 BC. This coinage, the next one, please. Head of Zeus Amarius on the obverse and the league's monogram and the city's parasimon on the reverse. Dyme had to assume responsibility against the league. The use of the verb hieroforo, this they were accused of hieroforeon, might designate legal grounds on which members of the Achaean League prosecuted counterfeiters. It could also be that the verb is related with counterfeiting the coinage as a sort of sacrilege against the city's nomima. A second adikima is also plausible. It is interesting to know that a silver Achaean tetrabol issued by the city of Dyme was in fact a silver-plated coin. It cannot be excluded that the epigraphic document reporting the decision of the court and the silver-plated tetrabol are linked. Now, should I continue with the Athenian coinage decree and the Amphictyonic law about the Athenian tetradrachm, or we are all very tired and we want to discuss?
In fact, Selenia, I was going to suggest, because we are running a little bit over already, that perhaps we could do another in the future, we could do part 2 of this, where you could then discuss the coinage decree and the rest of that, because that will, of course, become very difficult and very dense as well. And I'm sure will elicit a lot of discussion. So if you don't mind, now would be actually a very good place to ends this first part and perhaps take some questions if you'd like. This has been absolutely
I don't
wonderful.
Have a problem. I know it's very tiring for you. I'm sorry it's so dense, but
Well, no, I mean, it is absolutely fascinating. And as always, and, you know, with your work, it is very thorough. You know, all of the possibilities seem to be covered, and there is a tremendous amount to discuss in terms of all of this. So if there are any questions from anybody at the moment, I'm sure Seleni would be happy to entertain those questions. Although I need to change my screen so I can see if we do have any.
It doesn't seem, we don't have questions for the
moment. Lucia.
Hi. I thank you, this is fantastic. It was fantastic
as always.
Really. And it would be, but yes, I mean, I think it would be fantastic if you don't have, of course, to agree now, but to have you coming a second time to discuss basically making the part two, because that would be amazing. Then
one quick question, actually probably not a very quick question that I do have, you know, at the very beginning of your talk, you were discussing valuation of coins and how, you know, there is, you know, what is considered a metallic or intrinsic value, a nominal value, commercial value, and so forth. And obviously, a nominal value to a large degree is something which is related to nomos, to law and legislation and the rest, as opposed to market. You know, the question that I have, and one thing that always perplexes me, is how those sort of values, nominal values particularly, are enforced. You know, there's, you know, as with all legislation, there's two parts. There's the actual legislation, there's the law, but the law really doesn't mean anything unless it is enforced. And, you know, as you demonstrated, there are, you know, a handful of examples where nominal value seems to have been enforced, or at least some sort of value seems to have been enforced.
Yes, values were enforced, exactly. That's why you have from in Macedonia, in the Kingdom of Macedonia, in the north, you have all, and also in the Peloponnese, you have in the late 5th century, coins whose nominal value does not correspond to their metallic value.
Yeah,
in fact, this is, let's say, a preludium of the bronze coinage, where the metallic value, nominal value, has absolutely no relation.
Right. But there's always going to be a tension between what the market value of something may be. You know, once the market receives those coins and they make their own assessments, you know, they as the market, the people, you know, using the coins, you know, there does then seem to be tension between, or possibility of tension between, you know, what the market values the coin at versus what the state, you know, would value the coin at, and how, you know, that can be resolved. You know, and I'm not sure if we have enough information from, you know, certainly the archaic, you know, classical, or even the Hellenistic period to, you know, explore that tension any further. But, you know, there are, you know, a few hints now and then again about that tension, percolating and being resolved or not in one case or another. John, you were about to make a comment?
I was going to say the best way to see that, Peter, is in hoards, especially when Dionysus overvalued gold silver all got buried, which is why you have these big hoards in the early 4th century of Sicilian coins. So you can see when the state's values didn't hold, Gresham's law starts to apply and coins disappear. And then you can try to measure that by what shows up in hoards and what's in circulation. But that, I mean, in terms of how you try to answer your question. But Seleni, I think for the next version of this, what would be fascinating to me would be you to talk about the epigraphical evidence in relation to the current debates over what, why were Greek coins struck and what their purpose was. Because I think most of the modern accounts of why the Greeks struck coins ignore the epigraphic evidence. or just don't have the capability of dealing with it, you know, because the Epicrates decree, I mean, you know, is to me the, you know, can't get more obvious than a state caring about money supply than that decree. And yet that doesn't seem to be, you know, fit into a lot of what the people are talking about today in terms of the purpose of coinage.
Hear, hear.
Yeah. Very good. Yeah. Yes. Yes, and I think it's a very interesting point that you made, John. And to come back to what your answer, Peter, I would like to say that the fact that we have these laws means that there were problems.
Right.
When the Olbia needs to fix the exchange rate for the citizen starter, we can understand that there was this background for this. There are certain reasons for this.
Right. Yeah, precisely. Are there any other questions or comments? All right. Well, Seleni, ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ. Thank you very much.
Εγώ ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Yeah, it was absolutely wonderful. And we will schedule part two of this because I'm very much looking forward to the continuation and to having more discussion about this very fascinating and very interesting topic. So thank you again, and look forward to seeing you very soon. So
I hope that
bye-bye. Thank you.
So happy to see you tonight. Jonathan and